your camera. So let's do a quick demo with this so you guys have a gist of what the heck you guys are looking at.
Should be able to see me in there, right? Red, orange, and yellow guy. So basically, in a nutshell, if you were a bridal party, I would be the hottest thing inside the fitter right now. Yeah, uh-huh. See, jokes. I got them. Mark's like, yeah, it's not funny. So now, we're looking for cold, which are going to be blue and black. We're looking for them to either take shape or to start moving on their own. When I say take shape, it's normally in the form of a person. So we're going to be looking for basically people looking at us or walking around us that are not supposed to be there. So our skin temperature is 97 to 99 degrees. So again, obviously we're going to be the warmest thing out here. Now, the other way I have this video set up is that there's a blue dot bouncing around the screen. The blue dot is there for when you get your full video back to help guide your eye of the coldest spot in the frame at that particular moment. I'm normally looking for 15 to 20 degree temperature drops based on the ambient temperature that we have tonight of 47. So basically I'm going to be looking for 32 degrees and colder of taking shape or moving on its own. Windshields and glass are not going to be moving on their own. Those are going to be the coldest things out here of a physical world kind of thing. So I'm going to go ahead and stop the video because as great as the software or the hardware is, the software sucks. So if we record for too long.
All right, guys, let's spread out. I'm going to keep the knees behind. The husband Charles, the son Charles, they left the Charles. So now we need another clue as to which one it actually is. So hopefully it's going to pop up.
3.8,
7.8. So, yeah, so go ahead and take a look at it. On this big dial, whenever it's cold and you can't get anything out, turn it counterclockwise down to 6 o'clock. Yes, please. And then go back up to 9. We're also going to turn up the sensitivity down here. Now that we're not here in the electrical pole, we should have an improvement in this case, but obviously we do. There's nothing electrical near us. Yeah. In the event that you want to ask something about your age, I will show you if you take that dial and you turn it, it'll give you more colors. A little bit further to the numbers. Yes. It'll also give you happy emojis, because you know every colonial woman knows what a smiley face is. I hate that. I hate the yes no too. So yeah, just play
2.7.
With it. We're going to escalate past 8.3. Now that we've escalated, that way I don't get in a whole level of fun. So now that you've gotten some, it is a little freaky tonight. I'm a little hesitant about using the ribbon cord just because dust in the air Carlson can cause it to get blocked. So I'm going to show you how to use the numbers. So in the back, there's a little flap. Underneath that flap, there's two white buttons. One closer to the edge, press it into the device. I don't know how you guys do it.
Okay.
again, not always a in the moment type thing, but when we do capture it, it is a holy shit moment, just cool. So you know. Like, it is a in your face, that's a person that shouldn't be there. Because wow. I always verify with another camera. Because there's always another camera pointed somewhere.
Cool.
So.
Yeah. Sorry about yelling, I'm just tired. You're not bored.
Right, no, you're not bored.
Oh, let's go. And the next one. Come on.
We're not done here yet. We're going to give them another minute because we do actually have some decent readings come out of the EMS detectors. This is good.
All right, question for you. Yeah, I've always wondered this. When a building is gone, the spirits, are they in any way to or are they still moving?
Average here is not going to be 2.5, so good point. It's going to be around 5. Just so you know, we do have lamp posts near us, so that's giving off a little bit of EMF in a tight space. So anything above, like, say, a 5 or a 6, I'll be excited about. So every ghost tour comes down here. This is Philadelphia Alley. This is actually used to be called a dual lane. This is for some of the
up a lot of heat that direction. That's interesting.
Location from both spaces.
No, it's just the building should retain heat.
We can't actually go all the way down. We're not allowed to. I'm going to talk about that because I've actually been kicked out of here. That's the fun part of the story. I was like, yeah, let's do this. So, here's how the story goes. You are so focused on that thing. I love it. She has been like laser focused waiting for something to happen. That device, by the way, this is the reason, this location is why we have that device. Who's down here, and by the way, his name is Dr. Joseph Brown Ladd. So for those of you with the spirit boxes, if you hear Brown Eyed Girl, it is not by accident or coincidence. We have the name Brown. Anyway, he moves down here because he's supposed to get married to his fiance, Amanda. Amanda just inherited a bunch of money from her dead parents. She has an attorney helping her out with all of this cash. The attorney thinks that Dr. Ladd is just after Amanda's money. So he tells Amanda, so usually pretty quick to determine after I'm done talking about the history of the space, why we're there, if we actually have something going on or not. Again, Anne is said to be seen all over town because she came down here to sell the things from her father's plantation. I'm going to talk about that in just a moment. Before we leave the space, I'll also tell you about this gate, because not all the other tourists will do that. This gate, remember that the alley was cut off on this side? In the event there was a dead guy, the loser of the duel, this was the shortcut to get to St. Philip Cemetery on the other side of the wall. Ways here. The wrought iron was probably put in the early 1900s based on the ironwork of it, but the archway was definitely there. This is just a courtyard, and you're going to see when we get around to the St. Philip side that you're going to see everything's gated off. It probably wouldn't have been back in the mid-1700s. So, I say, now we actually, you've been just holding that perfect. We're going to have a nice clear view of the alley from the SLS camera, so hopefully we don't get too many things. I've been kind of keeping an eye on it from the brush, because that will pick up from any leafy stuff, will give us stick figures kind of going along with it. Any other terms show up before we leave the space?
Few.
What do you got?
Well, after will add chick, eat, achieve, stay, report, formula, hot, and include.
This shit is weird. Like, it doesn't normally curse at us. The funniest thing, it gave us the F-bomb one night when I handed it to like this 80-year-old woman. I'm like, oh my god, what has happened? Like, so I'm kind of really careful with that. Anything coming out of your Ouija board over there?
Still just gibberish.
Gibberish, no R-I at all?
No.
No, nothing at all. Julie, did you hear anything?
I don't know.
You have an earbud in? Or you've been
listening? No, Jeff does.
Jeff does. You took it.
Do you hear anything?
Did you hear anything while we've been here? Not really. I know you were kind of focused on me, and it can be hard to do.
Yeah. Nothing to speak of.
We got one winner. Whoa. Oh, it's a rat.
It's a rat.
That's our cue, everybody. Let's roll.
Hello, buddy.
You're all filming him. Like, it's going to be on YouTube tomorrow.
Oh, it is.
That's a big rat. Right there. Is it jump on you?
Oh, I see.
Is it really a rat?
Yes. He's a beautiful rat.
Gee, there's look.
A beautiful rat.
What's wrong with rats?
Look at him looking at us.
Are you religious? God made them.
God made all.
What's funny is I used to tell that story like right outside the alley against that white building, and I noticed that we had rats coming in off the edges of it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So I was like, I better go back into the alley. So that's why we only go down that quarter way, and then we just exit the same way. And it's better to get some footage while we're actually in the alley.
Yeah.
So anybody hear anything, see anything before we get started with why we're here? Jeff, you got nothing?
Nothing.
Okay. Anything coming up on Ouija?
Just the letter U so far.
Letter U.
I wish it would do something coherent, like a word.
So with, I will tell you, with that specific device, we're still teaching the ghosts how to use it. They're not used to using EMF detection to communicate. So
okay. I don't know what I'm doing.
You broke it again. You just turned off the backlight. Not a big deal. So whenever you think something's wrong, the top left button of the face, just hold it down until it goes off, and then turn it back on.
Okay, thank you.
You got it. All right, so, Tom, did you get anything on the way here?
So, kind of like this.
All right, so while we're in here, after we're done with the history, we will spread out in this location.
Wife, the mistress's daughter is Anne.
Right.
Got it.
I haven't mentioned the wife yet, but good call. So, the
well,
three of them.
If there's a mistress, there's got to be a wife.
Yeah.
The three of them are running away from her father's angry wife. So, they have to leave Ireland in 1708. How pissed off was that woman, ladies? I'm just putting it out there. Like, that's a big deal.
No potatoes for you.
I know, right? They land in Georgetown. That's just north of us, between us and Myrtle Beach. So, Dad bought a plantation. Mom died pretty quickly. That means Dad is sending young Anne down here to Charleston to sell things from the plantation to help keep things afloat. Hence the familiar building. Again, they live in Georgetown. So, that's a long trek by horse and carriage to sell things from a plantation. But back home in Ireland, Anne was said to be kind of a badass. They say when she was only 7, 8, 9 years old, remember this is pirate lore, no exact numbers, that she killed one of her servants with a knife to the belly. So again, we have gotten servant, knife, and belly all in the same evening. Let's fast forward. Building's done in 13. By 1715, pirates are coming through Charleston pretty heavy. Anne is stoked. Why? Because she's going to fall in love so she can earn her freedom, just like a man, a man's world. First guy she falls in love with. This is James Bonney. I said first because there's a handful, and we're going to go through them. James Bonney is a filthy pirate. Dad doesn't approve. They ran away to Jamaica. They got married, and Cormac became Anne Bonny. That's where the name comes from. Oh. But when they got there, James Bonny is not Captain Jack Sparrow like what she was hoping for. Because every young lady wants a Captain Jack Sparrow, right? So, this guy is a privateer. He's a spy for the British. This is not who she wants. He's a coward. So he's basically rebelling against his own people. So a few years later, she falls in love again. Guy number two. John Rackham, a.k.a. Calico Jack. This is the guy that they based your Johnny Depp character off of. Just so you know, Calico Jack. He has his own ship and wants to be part of it. You can't put a girl on a pirate crew. Does anybody know why? And keep it family friendly. There's young ears here.
Who is she safe from the others?
It's cursed bad luck. It's bad luck. Oh. Right. Bad luck. That's the cursed bad
especially
luck.
Especially if they're redheaded.
You're screwed.
That's funny. Yeah. It is bad luck. That's what we're going to go with. So good job. And again, you wouldn't believe half the answers I hear from that question. So he makes a deal with her. If you dress like a guy and look like my crew, you can be part of it. But you're going to be a female in my quarters. Most of us are adults here. Let's put two and two together. Being a female in his quarters, she's eventually going to get pregnant. Cannot have a pregnant pirate dude on the crew. Somebody's going to figure out that she's a girl. So he, before she starts the show, drops her off in Cuba. Go have the baby here, come back later, we'll figure it out. She goes and has the baby, but returns with no baby. We have no idea what happened to the child, and all of the research I've done on pirates and Anne Bonny, can't find it. The part of the story that's important is that she comes back dressed as a female. This makes Jack angry. And while she was away giving birth to his baby, this is not our last stop, we still got one more to go. Let's see what we can find out about Anne Bonny. Any crazy terms showing up out of you?
During.
During.
Wordless.
It's actually been
wordless. Pretty decent. So it says during and then disease, bacteria, choose,
yeah, like disease.
Comparison.
What's nice about yours is I don't have to write them down. It does it for me.
Thank you.
What do you look like?
What'd you say?
We're at?
Over there.
By the electrical pole.
Yes, by the electrical pole.
Okay. Anything?
I found it.
Drown.
And twice, and then stop, kill, you're close, kill you, kill, kill. And then drown, didn't you?
Yes,
oh,
it did.
And I got drowned. I forgot. I got drowned for that.
Okay. Lots of kill.
Yeah, a
drown.
Lot of kills. And a lot of ands.
Richard. How are you guys doing over here?
I've heard of Richard. Harry, in the river.
Okay.
Help him.
His audio caught it, or my audio. But in the river, their plantation was on a river. Had to be. It was a rice plantation.
Yeah.
So, again, kind of a stretch, but yeah. I'm putting clues together of like, is it in some of my relatives to the rice plantation, or is it in George Carmen? So, very interesting. Anything else you guys got going on? More kills? Yeah, I got drowned already.
Yeah, drowned. A lot of ways to die.
A lot of ways to die. And
virus,
you have
no.
I like the bacteria. That's very cool with the surge.
Oh, I did get a doctor.
You got a doctor?
I got a doctor when you...
So it moved with you?
One of
yeah, but then it...
With you?
Yes.
The yes. Ghost?
The ghost moved with us.
But then it moved out.
And then it left. And I'll tell you, I knew when it left because there was this loud boom.
She's so loud because she's so deaf.
Just kind of like, let's experiment with this space. I had a very small group. They were willing to experiment. And we came in, and there's tons of monuments in here, so I didn't know who we were going to come up with. Speaking of, that's Washington, like George himself, standing right there over us. This is Washington Park, in case you didn't know where you're at. But what we found was the exact birth year of the man on the bust directly behind me, along with his first name and part of his last name. His name is Henry Timrod. We had Henry and Tim show up on spirit boxes, and we had the year 1828 specifically show up on a spirit box. And we didn't know what it meant in real time. So we're like, wait a minute, let's look around at the monuments and see what we got. So we spread out and we found Henry. I will tell you about Henry, I've heard his story in the past, but I had to kind of do a little bit more research to see what's going on. Quick story on Henry. He's sick for most of his life, obviously alive during the Civil War. Part of the Civil War, obviously on the Confederate side. So he goes to the battlefield, but his friends realize he's too sick to fight. So they sent him home, knowing that he was a writer, and said, why don't you go be the voice of the war? And he came home and started writing poetry about what was going on the battlefield of the Civil War. He became known as the Laureate of the Confederacy. Very cool title. A couple years after he came home, he has a son. His son, which hopefully you guys are going to find out his name through your spirit boxes, has a very specific, obviously a birthday, but it does fall on a holiday. So hopefully you're going to find that out as well, but died at a very young age. So it's kind of a tragic moment for him. Two more years after that, his college friend calls him up and says, you know what, I got a cottage out here in Columbia. I'm going through a hard time. You got to finish writing this piece with the paper you're working with. And 8-minute interaction with Henry by his bust. And when I say interaction, it was, Henry, can I read a stanza from one of your poems? Raise your right hand. And we watched the figure raise his right hand and then lower it. Again, 8 minutes of that. How it ended was the only woman in our group went over to the side where he was standing, and I walked around him several times so we had a point of reference. She walked over and outstretched her hand and asked Henry to shake her hand, and he disappeared. Reason being, she's a woman. He's in the 1800s. It's probably very disrespectful for a female to offer her hand to be shaken during those times, and we never got him back. Again, craziest thing ever. We moved the camera to make sure it was legit. I walked around several times. We had a point of reference. Like, craziness. Mm-hmm. So.
Which camera picked that up?
Somebody had an SLS camera, like Sam's, but he didn't know how to record with it. Because you're listening to staff.
This thing was giving me letters all over the place.
Go talk to Nick and see if you did something to it.
Oh, probably.
Nope.
Thank you.
stop. They got a corner of the wood stop.